morning. My name is Jennifer. This morning we're going to read a passage from Mark chapter 10. If you would pull out your Bibles and read along with me. Mark chapter 10, verses 1 through 16. And he left there and went to the region of Judea and beyond the Jordan. And crowds gathered to him again, and again, as was his custom, he taught them. And Pharisees came up, and in order to test him, asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of divorce and to send her away." And Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this commandment. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." And in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. And he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." And they were bringing children to him that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. My name is Tyler Twombly. If you have never met me before, I'm one of the pastors here at New King. I am excited as we learn today and continue from our study in the Gospel of Mark. As we focus our hearts and minds, please join me in prayer. Lord, I thank you for the people in this room today. I thank you for the privilege that it is to be among those whom you have called out and declared to be your children by grace through faith. I pray, Lord, as we study these verses today, we would not let any distractions or obstacles in our heart keep us from trusting in you. Lord, your will, your plan, your design is perfect, though we aren't perfect. What makes following you so hard, Lord, is the reality of what's in my own heart. I pray, Lord, as we study these verses today, you would help each of us to lay down the obstacles in our heart. I pray, Lord, you would give us hearts of compassion and grace towards those around us, to the widow, the orphan, and the needy, Lord. I pray for anyone in this room who has not believed in Christ before, that they would see Jesus' teachings and understand who he is and desire to follow him. And I pray, Lord, for any one of us in this room going through any suffering or hardship, or wrestling with sin in their own heart, they would see that what Jesus offers is a burden that is light and easy. Lord, I pray that you would use my imperfect words to preach your perfect truth. I pray these things in your name. Amen. I'm very excited today to talk to you from the Gospel of Mark. I realize that may sound surprising after what we have just read already in the Scriptures, but I love the teachings of Jesus primarily just because there is great wisdom and great value and great guidance in what he says. Even though it's not always easy, it is always the best way. I was humbled this morning. I was trying to listen to something relatively spiritual to help set my heart and mind forwards to preaching today, and one of the things that I listen to is called In the Lord I Take Refuge. It is a book by Dane Ortlund, a commentary on the Psalms, And it was on one of the Psalms where at the beginning, David cries out to the Lord, questioning God, why do people with haughty and flattering lips succeed? There are a few things more humbling as a public speaker than the reality of the problem of haughty lips. So that immediately humbled me today. It's like I have to be very careful with what I say and what I teach, because someone who flatters merely tries to flatter other people and soften what the scriptures say just to make people feel comfortable is not someone who is honest or has your best interest at heart. That's very hard to think about. As we have been walking through the Gospel of Mark, we are in this portion of Mark where Jesus has revealed specifically to his disciples who he is in full. And even to few, they have seen his glory revealed. Can you imagine what it's like to see Jesus' full glory? It's one thing to read about it. It's another thing to see it face to face. And so Jesus reveals himself in his full glory, and now he is walking on the way towards Jerusalem with his disciples, trying to teach them what does it really look like to be a genuine follower of Christ. Now, a lot of these topics are addressed because of things either the disciples have said or questions that come up from others as they're on the way. And often how Jesus responds is not by answering the question directly, which is actually very wise. Jesus does not answer a lot of these questions here directly. Rather, he speaks to the heart. Here is kind of where we have been. There is an outline here just for each of us for the sermons that we have done and gone through. We've talked about Jesus' teaching on the way the last week, and primarily Jesus is addressing humility amongst his disciples and what it looks like to be someone who puts to death sin in their life. That is what it means to be a follower of Christ, to consistently lay down our own pride and our own sin in order to follow Jesus. This week, we will see Jesus continue that very idea by presenting the examples of marriage and children. And actually, next week, what we will see in our very possessions connects to what we're studying this week. It's actually really a part of the same discussion or same various themes. Basically, what does it look like to be discipled by Jesus through our very lives, through everything, whether that's our standard for God's design, God's value in the least of these, the children, or in what we give God by sacrificing our own possessions to follow him. We are supposed to be, as Christ followers, willing to give up any and everything to follow God's design, what is best. So we have teaching on the way, part one, part two, and part three. Parts two and three are kind of together. Because part three is rather expansive, we discussed it each other among the elders, what exactly would be a good follow-up, and we are going to talk about biblical giving right after that. This is going to be more of a topical discussion, but what does a heart of complete sacrifice look like in the entirety of Scripture, not just from this one part? And then last is teaching on the way, part four, where Mark will give us the true example of what it looks like to follow Jesus. And he's going to show us through the disciples' incredible questions an example of one man who is willing to do that, who is not one of his disciples. So that is kind of where we've been, where we're going together. I hope that's helpful, especially as we look at what we're studying today, which is not an easy passage. I have to be honest here, I was nervous about preaching these verses for two reasons, really. First, because Paul, in 2 Timothy, encourages Timothy, he reminds him that the weight of someone who teaches the Scripture is very heavy, because it takes time, it takes research. Paul tells Timothy to rightly handle the word of truth. And the word that he uses is actually a word that was commonly used in farming to describe trying to plow a straight line in the field. If you try to plow a line quickly, it's just going to end up jagged and all over the place. But you have to take your time in plowing a line in the field in order that the road, the avenue that you have made for planting is straight, so that things grow properly. In the same way, if we do not take our time to rightly handle the word of truth, growth in our own life will not happen. So it's hard because it takes time and research. It's also hard for me because these verses are very personal. What Jesus talks about is not something easy. What he talks about is something that each and every one of us have either experienced in our own life, or we have family and friends who have experienced those very same things. Many of us either have family or friends who have been affected by divorce. Jesus addresses that idea today, and it doesn't make it easy. Jesus addresses the value of children. Now, many of us, whether we have children or we know people with children, they've been affected by things that happen in their children's lives. It's very often that we ask in these times of hardship and suffering, why, God, would you do this? These are not easy verses. And in the same way, each of us live in a time and circumstance where possessions are glorified. So the passage that we study next week will be equally as hard because it makes each of us ask, how should I view what I own and my possessions in view of a king who gave them to me? These passages are not easy. They take very intentional time. All three of these topics, marriage, family, and possessions, are deeply personal. We must be diligent in trying to understand them, what it means to follow Jesus, and how to communicate them with honesty and grace. We have to balance God's clear model with compassion for those who have gone through hardship. If there's one thing I would like you to come away with today, this is my one thing, my main idea. It's this, that Jesus teaches the heart of a true disciple is marked by complete dependence on the work of God. It may seem on the surface, how is it that a question about divorce relates to a follow-up discussion about children? It's not just because Jesus wants to make an example of family structure, which is true. I think he does want to use God's example and design for a family structure, what God wants it to look like on purpose. But at the same time, Jesus is going to drop little bits of information in each of these passages that connect them together, both of which will address hard-hearted sin. Hard-hearted sin in our own life that separates us from God. And at the same time, he also uplifts an example. A true follower is dependent on God's work alone and not our successes or our failures in life. We, in this passage, are forced to look at what Jesus says and trust that he is the great physician who can fix the hardness that is in our heart. One of the hardest things I have ever had to do, our daughter Eloah, she is about to be 4 years old. We went through a season almost 2 years ago now, which is crazy to say, where Eloah had to have multiple surgeries on her hips. It was a complete surprise to us. We had no idea about it. There were just little signs. In the end, we were told, ultimately, Eloah is going to have at least one major surgery in order to be fixed. And one of the hardest things me and Brittany have ever had to do is offer up our daughter to a stranger, a doctor who promises he knows what to do. In the same way, when we read these verses, it forces us with one decision alone. Will you accept Jesus' teaching and trust him as the great physician, the only one who can fix the brokenness in the human heart? With that in mind, let's see how Jesus does that. He has two examples in order to communicate dependence on God today. The two examples he uses are in marriage, or a question about divorce, and in the example of children who are brought to him. As we read through these verses, it's important. I want to set the tone here for just a second. It's important to remember Jesus is not about to say everything you would want him to say about marriage, divorce, and children. That's very important because it's easy when you read the Bible, especially say you're just reading through Mark on your own, it's easy to read these verses and make an immediate foundational decision based on what Jesus says without having all the information. Jesus in no way is trying to give you all the information about a certain topic or subject. So what he says, we're going to study and look at together and try to take in all the information so that we can rightly handle God's word. Jesus ultimately has other intentions for addressing what he wants to address, and we cannot forget, as we read the verses, that the way that Jesus wants us to follow is ultimately the way that led him to the cross. Jesus is not without compassion or grace. In fact, he displayed it by giving up his very own life. So as you wonder, is Jesus trustworthy? Are his ways actually best? Remember, they are. Here's how Jesus does that. If you'll look with me in Mark chapter 10, verse 1, it says, "And he left there and went to the region of Judea and beyond the Jordan. Crowds gathered to him, and again, as was his custom, he taught them." I think this first verse is really important as Jesus has been going town to town teaching. Remember, the thing he's been teaching is repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. So he is traveling, preaching the gospel to the crowds, saying there is freedom and forgiveness from sin if you follow my way. And many people have been coming to him wanting to know more. So Jesus is in this setting. He is teaching the gospel to these people, and he's doing so in a region called Judea in the area beyond the Jordan. That little note might be very important to what happens in the verses that follow. See, Jesus has been teaching in this area, but the other person who's taught in this area is John the Baptist. So in many ways, Jesus is following up what John the Baptist has taught, but many even of the questions that come from this passage relate to some things that also may have happened to John the Baptist. So now Mark is trying to set the stage for the context, the reason that a lot of these questions come up. Jesus is teaching the gospel as he does, and he's doing so in a region where John the Baptist was the primary teacher. We continue in verses 2 through 4. The Pharisees come up to Jesus. Here's what it says. "And the Pharisees came up, and in order to test him, asked, 'Is it lawful for man to divorce his wife?'" Now, Matthew, in his gospel, has the very same line of questioning with one little difference. In Matthew chapter 19, the ideas and structure is actually almost completely the same. Jesus is going to talk with his disciples about marriage, children, and possessions, and then it's going to give the example of a blind man at the end of Matthew chapter 19, and after that, Jesus enters Jerusalem. So Matthew and Mark have the same kind of order about how they present their information. They're coming up with the same ideas that Jesus is trying to get us to understand. However, Matthew adds one little detail that Mark seems to leave out. The one detail that Matthew includes that Mark leaves out is that when the Pharisees come to test Jesus, they ask Jesus, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any reason?" Now that's important because it was common in the culture to think of marriage and divorce from that perspective, that a man could in fact divorce his wife for any reason. In fact, there's basically two understandings in these verses, and even two understandings in the Old Testament that the Pharisees would have taught as far as what are rules or regulations for divorce. The first is that anyone could divorce as long as what happened is that the other spouse, the other person, had committed sexual immorality. So if they had broken the marriage covenant by cheating outside of marriage, then there was grounds for divorce. That would have been more of a conservative view. But what seems like the most popular view is that they believed a man could get divorced for any reason. That was the popular view. You actually, if you wanted to look this up, there is a rabbi by the name of Hillel who has written this down. You can still look this up if you want to find it. And this rabbi writes down that a man could divorce his wife for any reason, for example, if she makes dinner poorly. One of my favorite early marriage memories of me and Brittany is that Brittany wanted to make poppy seed chicken, a very common dish, I promise you, and a delicious one she has made since then, and it went very well. Brittany does not particularly enjoy the process of cooking. She very often will look at the ingredients and specifically the measurements and kind of overthink what exactly it's asking her. And to be fair, when you're in a rush or trying to think of how to cook something, tablespoon and teaspoon, like the letters are real small, okay? So in poppy seed chicken, it calls for at least one, maybe multiple teaspoons of salt. The response from the crowd is incredible. Brittany adds at least one, if not multiple, tablespoons of salt. That's a lot more than a teaspoon. She adds that, and I promise you, I did everything I possibly could to finish dinner. I ate it, and we had been married, I don't know, maybe a couple months, maybe. I ate it, and I'm going, okay, this is strong. It's a little strong. And Brittany is going, is it good? Do you like it? And I'm like, oh, God, that's pretty good. I like it. We make it again. That's good. And Brittany's like starting to eat it. And she goes, Tyler, you need to stop. Don't eat this. Please stop. And so according to Jewish teaching, there was a field who would have said, if a woman does not make dinner well, she could be divorced by her husband. That is the culture that they lived in. So there are these two schools of thought. Mark leaves that detail out for any reason. However, it's likely that he is assuming this, as there's really only one debate about whether divorce or remarriage is allowed, and that's the debate. What are the grounds or allowable reasons for divorce? And I think more than what exactly they thought culturally about divorce and remarriage, what is important from these verses is that Mark again notes the Pharisees, like they have done, have come to test Jesus. They have not come because they're interested in hearing what Jesus has to say. They are not coming because they want to hear all the reasons Jesus could give for divorce and remarriage. They have come to test Jesus to find what could possibly be a stumbling block. Now, why is it? Why would they want Jesus to have a stumbling block? We'll go back for just a second. Where is Jesus teaching? In an area where John the Baptist teaches. And why was John the Baptist beheaded? For his views on marriage. He directly addresses Herod's marriage to a woman named Herodias. And because of the way John the Baptist addresses that marriage, he is beheaded. I think while the verses don't say it, it would be foolish to rule out that kind of thinking from the Pharisees. They have come to test Jesus and to ask, can we provide a stumbling block for him that maybe could compromise his position and even get him killed? Jesus' answer then has to be correct. It has to be wise. He is not going to try and give every view you could possibly want about the subject. Rather, he is going to address the heart issue and God's unchanging truth. Here is how Jesus does that in verse 3. Jesus answered them, "What did Moses command you?" A very wise response, because what does he say? Instead of providing an immediate reaction, as often questions like these can get very emotional depending on how you answer, he asks them, these men who are supposed to uplift God's law, what does God's law say? And they said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of divorce to send her away. So rightly, the Pharisees quote what is Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 1 through 4. You can write that down and look it up later. But effectively, Moses, upon seeing that people are imperfect, writes in the law that a man and woman could get divorced based on certain things that happen. Now, when you read those verses, it becomes kind of obvious that part of what Moses is trying to do is actually mitigate the consequences of divorce on each party. And it would even seem that when Moses writes this, he's trying to defend the wife and what could happen to her based on the circumstances of divorce, because in their culture, it was very different for a woman and the consequences on her based on the consequences also of a man. But the Pharisees quote this because for them, this was a verse, Deuteronomy 24, that they would use to say God is okay with divorce. God instructs divorce. This is the verse that we'll go to for this, rather than viewing it the correct way, where it seems to be allowed based on things that happen, but not advised or not even God's goal for marriage. So they're trying to look for all the rules. What can I get away with and not be in sin? And Jesus says that that's not the point of what Moses says. Moses allowed it. That's not the same as advising it. Jesus then continues in verse 5. So he hears what they say, and here's how he responds. And Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this commandment. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. The first thing Jesus wants the Pharisees and even his disciples to understand, what is the real reason for divorce? Now, this is broad painting picture, okay? We're painting broad strokes with this idea. The reason for divorce, broad stroke, is because of sin in the human heart. It's because of hardness in the human heart. God's ultimate design is not for people who are joined together to be divorced. God's design in marriage for his followers is not that they would approach marriage and think, if it doesn't work out, I could just pursue divorce if I want to. Rather, God's standard is different, and his way is best. We have to remember that the sin that is in our life comes from a hardness in our heart that is bent away from God, not towards him. This reality of the hardness of heart is not exclusive to those who have gone through divorce or those who are married. Rather, Jesus is pointing out a bigger heart issue. All of us have hardness in our heart. And that hardness in our heart helps us to realize, do we really follow God's standard? Do we hold fast to his design for all of our life, not just in this one aspect? Upon pointing out the hardness that is in the human heart, Jesus then uplifts God's standard, which is this. This is God's standard, his definition for marriage. Beginning, not in these verses, by the way, but beginning on the first couple pages of the Bible, where God creates man and woman. The very opening of the Bible begins with a marriage. And as God defines it, he says it's one man and one woman. It's not just about two people who could love each other. It's about one man and one woman joined into one flesh. They were two, and now they are one. and that ultimately remain together until death do us part. God's design is for permanence in marriage, until God himself changes the circumstances. It's important to realize, as Jesus addresses this question, what he goes back to is not his opinion, but God's unchanging truth that he wrote into the foundation of the world at creation. His blueprint, his order and design is the way marriage is intended to be. And his way is best. Now, having said that, as Christ followers, we have to be sensitive to those who go through hard times, hard situations, suffering especially in marriage. As we've already thought about, how many of us, if not all of us in the room, know, if not family, has gone through the hardship of divorce, we have friends or know of others who have gone through divorce. I really like, this is what Sam Storm said. It's quoted in Christ-Centered Exposition Commentary on the Gospel of Mark. Sam Storm writes in an article called Divorce and Remarriage this: in the church, we should emphasize the value and dignity of marriage. That's unchanging. God's view and design on marriage is a gift. It is something that is glorious and awesome because it ultimately reflects the love of God for us. That he would willingly sacrifice himself that we could be known by him. In the same way, in marriage, one man and one woman do the very same for the rest of their life. Marriage is a gift. We have to uphold the value and dignity of marriage while eliminating the shame and stigma of the divorced. We might mingle the call to obedience with the tears of compassion. Divorce is an exceptionally hard thing. It is easy on one hand to read these verses and make a statement about a standard. It's another thing to walk with someone through the hardships of divorce. As Christ followers, we hold highly God's view of marriage, and at the same time, we treat others with compassion and grace. The disciples do not quite understand what Jesus is saying. They find it very hard to take in what he says. In verse 10, it says, "And in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter." Matthew also adds a little portion that Mark seems to leave out. The disciples, upon hearing what Jesus says, they ask Jesus, "If this is God's standard, why would you even get married?" A hard question to ask, but when they view the hardness of their own heart in contrast with the standard of God, they ask themselves, would it not be easier just to remain single? Jesus hears their words, and in verse 11, he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." Now again, remember, what Jesus says in these verses is not everything that we would want to know on the subject. Because in Matthew, Jesus says no one can divorce their wife for any reason except for the case of sexual immorality. And so it would seem that in other places, when we take the host of Scripture, there are times where divorce is allowed based on certain circumstances. But because Jesus also is trying to uplift God's standard, his design for any who should desire to be married, and for any who are married, the goal of marriage that Jesus is trying to uplift is not that we should pursue divorce at all. Paul, even in the New Testament letter, says if a Christ follower is married to a non-Christ follower, they should not pursue divorce. But that by remaining committed to someone, the gospel would still be proclaimed in marriage. What Jesus says here is trying to uplift God's design, not give every wise answer to each differing circumstance that happens in marriage. So as Christ followers, remember, we need to uplift God's design. But at the same time, for any who are going through divorce, I'm so sorry. At New King, we do hate divorce for two reasons. First, because ultimately God's design is that a man and woman should willingly sacrifice their life every day to see the gospel proclaimed in their marriage. And divorce does go against God's intended goal. That being said, we hate divorce for another reason, because of what it does to people. I've not been divorced, but I cannot imagine what it's like to go through it. We hate divorce because ultimately the repercussions of it affect people every day for the rest of their life. Have compassion and grace. Seek to encourage and remind people where their identity is really found. Not in whether we're married or whether we're single, but whether we know Christ. And ultimately, that's what we point people to, is satisfaction in Him. No matter whether they're married and struggling or going through divorce, what we point people to is satisfaction and peace that can only be found in Jesus, who gave up His life. Now again, the disciples don't quite understand what Jesus is saying. He's calling them to address the hardness that is in their heart. This hardness is revealed not just in their misunderstanding, but also in their reaction to some people that come up to them. So in verse 13, we've seen Jesus talk about marriage. Now we're going to see Him talk about children. So He uses this example to talk about hardness of heart. Now He's going to use the example of children to talk about entrance into God's kingdom. An interesting turn of themes. What happens in verse 13 is this: and they were bringing children to Him that He might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. So here's what's happening. Jesus has been traveling through the crowds. He has been trying to teach people the gospel, and as people are coming up to Him, strangers, those who are not following Him, they're bringing their children to Jesus. They see Jesus as a holy man of God, and when He speaks, things happen. So they're bringing their children to Him, not merely for miracles, but rather just that Jesus would pronounce a blessing on their children. Almost like just a standard baby dedication. They're bringing the children to Jesus, and the disciples, in their pride, in their lack of grace and compassion, it says, rebuke them. That would be, it seems, not specifically the children, but those who are bringing the children to Jesus. Now, why is it that the disciples would rebuke them, and what does it even mean that they rebuke them? When it says that they are rebuking them, it means they are filled with intense anger towards those who are bringing children to Jesus. Now, this is different. I like a pastor that I once had. His name's Tony Morita. He rightly points out in his sermon on Mark chapter 10 that in their culture, it was very different than our culture. In our culture, we would drop any and everything for our children to make a sports practice. That's just the reality. We would do that. In their culture, they would have not done the same thing, because children ultimately are completely dependent on their parents. They are not capable of providing anything for the family structure until they are of age. So as far as who is least valuable in the culture, children are not very high on the value list. They are towards the bottom. And so now when the disciples are filled with anger, they are effectively saying, what you are bringing to Jesus is not worth His time. He is on the way somewhere else. There is a goal and destination we're trying to go. He's trying to teach certain things. You don't need to bring your children to Jesus. Jesus sees the pride and the elitism that is in their hearts as if they're better. And he addresses what they say this way. In verse 14, but when Jesus saw it, he was indignant. That is, Jesus responds to their anger with his own frustration and anger towards them. And he said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them. Jesus first says, let them come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. So he says, there is no reason for you to send them away. There is no reason for you to be a stumbling block or a gate or a wall for people being able to come to me. Now, I think this is important, especially as we think about the verses before. There is a wide variety of opinion and interpretations on the practical implications of what you do with marriage and divorce in the Bible. But there is no reason to become a stumbling block. There is no reason to be the kind of person who is so prideful and so set on your own opinion that you push people away from Christ rather than helping them find their satisfaction in him. In the same way, Jesus is saying about these children, do not be a wall for them. He says, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. This should remind you of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5 through 7, where Jesus, what does he uplift? What is the spirit the disciples are supposed to have in Matthew 5? He says the kingdom belongs to those who are poor in spirit, who are broken and contrite of heart. In the same way, a child, what are they to their parents? Completely dependent. In the same way, we are supposed to approach God with that same level of brokenness and desperation. Are you dependent on God? These children are completely dependent on their parents. And in the same way, their parents then are completely dependent on Jesus. They are coming, recognizing Jesus is the only one who can truly bless. And yet the disciples want to keep them away. To the poor and dependent is the kingdom of God. And he says, truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child will not enter it. Something that completely separates people who come to Jesus in the Gospel of Mark is this. When they come to Jesus, they are broken, they are needy, they are desperate. They know there is only one solution to their problem. And if it's not Jesus, there is no solution. In the same way, you and I, when we approach the problems of life, should come to Jesus thinking he's the only one who can solve my problem. And if he can't, then there is no solution. Lord, I will depend on you. To those who see Christ as the way, the truth, and the life, to those who know that Jesus is the only way, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Jesus promised then for each and every one of us who puts our trust and our faith in Jesus is that you are a child of God. Jesus follows this, and he took them in his arms and he blessed them. And he laid his hands on them. As Jesus has done with many of those he's done miracles with, or even those who just needed help. His desire to physically touch and be with those who are needy and desperate shows his compassion and care. Remember, as these teachings may be hard and difficult as they address our heart, we cannot forget in Jesus' teaching, he always is compassionate and kind. In the next set of verses that we'll look at next week, when the man comes up to him, the rich young ruler, and the man asks Jesus, what must I do to be saved? Jesus says, you follow the law, and that's it. And the man says, well, I've done that the entirety of my life. And Jesus, it says, looking upon him, loved him. And loving him, he said, give all your possessions to the poor and follow me. An equally hard teaching in these verses, but Jesus, as he teaches this, does not do so without compassion and kindness and care. Jesus deeply loves all people and desires for them to know him and access him and be with him. The only question remains, if you're a follower, are you dependent on him? As we close today, I have just a few practical thoughts. In terms of marriage, God's design, his blueprint, his way is ultimately for our best. If we are married, our marriages flourish when we follow God's design. For those of you that are married in this room, do you accept his call on each of you in marriage? In Ephesians chapter 5, it says of the husband that you are to love Christ as Christ loved the church. Now, we very often will study and read the next set of verses which say that a woman should submit to her husband, which is ultimately the call to trust a husband in the same way that you trust Christ. But men, don't forget, your call is to die every day for your wife in the same way that Christ died for his bride, the church. If you're married, will you follow that blueprint? If you're going through divorce, my first offer is this: I'm so sorry. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is in John chapter 4, where Jesus actually uses the example of a woman who's been divorced and remarried multiple times. And upon seeing her, Jesus doesn't say, clean your life up and then you can come to me. He comes to this woman asking for water. She says, who are you that you would ask for this? And he said, if you knew who I was, you would ask me for water. Jesus says, if you take the water that I drink, you'll be satisfied and never be thirsty again. If you're going through divorce, remember, Jesus is the one who satisfies. And he offers that hope and grace to all, no matter the circumstance. Rest in him today. If you're single, remember, your identity is not in that you would become married or that you would have children. If you're single, you are called to uphold God's design, his blueprint, but ultimately your identity is in whether you have believed in Christ in faith. And your identity is not found in whatever people would expect of you, but whether or not you have been made a child of God. So while these verses may not seem to apply to you, I promise they do. We submit our lives to God's design and our identity in him, whether married, divorced, or single. For thoughts on children, it gives me great encouragement to know Jesus cares what happens to my kids. Despite the fact that we have gone through medical issues with each of our kids in different ways, it is not the worst thing that has ever happened. For many, worse has happened for their children or people that they know, and I promise you, there is no story that makes my stomach turn like some kind of suffering that happens to children. Take comfort today knowing that the Lord sees our children and he cares for them. Finally, are you dependent like a child on God? Or are you still resting in your own pride, your own expectations for your life? My comfort is this: will you depend on God today? If you're wrestling with sin, will you confess that sin to depend on God's grace? Finally, if you are not a Christ follower in this room, his offer remains the same. Will you believe on him for salvation? Jesus' teaching on the way is constantly reminding us the way leads to his cross, his covering for sin in our life, his freedom from death in the grave. And if you believe on Jesus today, that he died for your sins, he paid for you, you have salvation and can be called a child of God. Will you accept that today? I'm going to pray and we will close with worship and communion. Lord, I thank you for your words. I thank you for your kindness and compassion on us. I pray, Lord, you would fill each of us in this room with the reality of your grace. Help us, Lord, to submit ourselves to your standard and your design. And in the same way, preach your gospel with grace and confidence. I pray, Lord, for those who are married in this room, that, Lord, you would protect our marriages. I pray, Lord, for those who have gone through divorce or are going through divorce, that you would comfort them today. I pray, Lord, for families who have gone through suffering with children, that you would help them to remember, Lord, that you see and you care. This doesn't always make the circumstances of our life easier, but thank you, Lord, that you walk with us through suffering. I pray, Lord, you would help us through that today, and that if there is any who has never believed in you, they would trust you for salvation today. I pray this in your name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing.